Welcome to the Heavy Spoilers Show, I'm your host Definition, and this episode we're breaking down Mac and Deke's bogus adventure. The latest entry is packed with a lot of cool little callbacks and Easter eggs, and throughout this video we'll be discussing everything you need to know about episode 7. Obviously there will be heavy spoilers here, so if you don't want anything ruined, then I highly recommend that you turn off now. Please drop a thumbs up if you enjoy the video, and make sure you subscribe to the channel for breakdowns on the show week by week. Without further ado, thank you for clicking this, and let's get into our breakdown. Okay, so last time on S.H.I.E.L.D., Mac's parents were revealed to be Chronicoms. Having learned the real ones died, he went out to get some air and have some alone time. Deke rushed out to join him, when all of a sudden the Zephyr jumped through time, leaving the pair stuck in the past. The episode opens with Deke being debriefed over what happened to them all the way back in 1982. With this being an 80s entry, it's very much laced with synth music, sweaters being used as scarves, and as always, the costume and set department knock it out of the park in recapturing the era. We join Russell, who gets a message from Sybil, aka the Predictor, asking for his help. Russell is a robot inventor, and this pretty much sets up the episode's storyline. The 80s inspired title sequence pops up, and I have to say that, from the off, I absolutely loved this episode. I've seen it getting slightly mixed reviews, as it does sort of feel a bit fillery and a stopgap at times, but there's a lot going on here jokes-wise, which keeps the ball rolling. Anyway, back with Mac and Deke, the former seems really defeated by the way things turned out, and he visits his parents' graves. Now, we did theorize that the past may have always played out the way that we've seen it, and the agents were actually just carrying out how things were always supposed to be. In our minds, this was a sort of causal loop, in which the Chronicoms always went back, and the agents always stopped them, and they weren't actually changing history. This was exemplified by Sousa, who was originally thought to be murdered, but as we discovered, the agents just took him with them. However, the fact that Mac's parents died does show that there are actual consequences, and it is possible to drastically change things. It was a great shot in the arm for me, as I do sort of feel that things have sort of been going on the tracks, very much in terms of, you know, everything's just going very smoothly. So seeing these graves here and realizing that there were real consequences really hit home. It was a nice little addition that adds a lot of tension to the way that things could go in the future of the series. Now, back with Russell, he builds a communicator that allows him to speak to Sybil. It turns out that, just like Project Insight, Sybil gave him blueprints that showed him how to build tech ahead of where humanity was, and she requests that he builds her some flesh. I kinda got a weird science vibe from this, with a nerd building a woman, but it goes beyond that in the entry, and he basically makes the robot from Rocky IV. Back with Mac, he goes to work on the model car that he was going to give to his younger version. As we know, Mac is obsessed with automobiles, and throughout the series, this has helped him bond with a lot of people, namely Ghost Rider. I think he wanted to keep his younger self on the same path, as his father likely steered him towards this due to comments made last week. This doesn't really go according to plan though, and Mac spirals into a depression, basically sort of becoming Thor in Endgame, and he sits about just making model cars and drinking beer. Deke visits him several times over the months and tells him to come to a bar, saying it's urgent. At the bar, Deke is doing what I would have done, which is just the plot of yesterday, and I'd be making myself famous off other people's talent. Deke sings Simple Minds, Don't You, which was of course used in The Breakfast Club, and it's one of the many callbacks to 80s movies. Deke has sort of been using his cover band as, well, a cover band, and with the rest of the group, he's trying to set these up as agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. There's the two twins, the Changs, and we get an A-team rundown on the rest of the team, which contains Roxy Glass, a Russian woman that I think is sort of meant to be a play on Bridget Nielsen, and a drummer who doesn't last too long. Now, basically, Deke wants Mac to be their leader, and they travel back to the lighthouse where we come face to face with a digital Coulson. He's taken on the look of Max Headroom, who was a popular figure in the 80s. People actually believe that he was artificial intelligence, so Coulson taking up his look here is a nice little callback to what were simpler times. I love the way that he works throughout the episode, and it's hilarious seeing the set being wheeled around. Now, in the wake of his apparent death last week, Coulson has been living life in a TV, and he explains that Sybil managed to escape too and is likely building new hunters. It turns out that every time there's a power surge, that strange markings appear, and these are likely linked to the Chronicoms. They're right too, as we see Sybil creating an army, And she kills Russell in what was, yeah, very, very gory. I don't know what it is, but S.H.I.E.L.D. seems to be getting bloodier every entry. And I think this is sort of to be more akin to the kind of slasher horrors at the time, as it seems to be referencing things like Friday the 13th. Deke shows up looking like Tom Cruise in Top Gun, and the group begin to train. They suck, but Deke gives Mac a silver shotgun axe, which is of course the character's signature weapon. Mac doesn't want to lead anymore, but he's gonna have to get used to the idea after the Chronicoms descend on the location. Now in the robot's design, I got a lot of cool 80s imagery mixed together, as it sort of reminded me of Knight Rider, E.T. mixed with the Terminator, and Short Circuit. I'm not even kidding, I think the head that they use is actually a laser that Short Circuit used too, so it's nice that all of this is brought together. They also reference the Daleks by saying exterminate, and it's clear that a lot of thought went into the design, as it's completely packed with references. It's from this point that the episode turns into sort of man versus machine, as the group face off against their evil robot enemies. There's references to Walk Like an Egyptian, and the arm scene from Predator. Rambo also gets a nod too as Max suits up, and we learn that the time stream is still in the base due to Coulson blowing up the basement last week. Sybil of course needs this to see the past so that she can plan how to do things, and the group take her on. We see one machine treads roll over an explosive, which I think is a nod to Terminator, but things take a turn for the worse when we learn that the robots can fire laser beams. The group manage to take them out, and Deke hilariously calls Mac Daddy, which he sadly turns down. Now, whilst it does seem like they saved the day, a small robot gets away with the time stream, meaning that Sybil will be able to lead the Chronicoms in the future. The group celebrate, and Mac and Deke head to his uncle's, where his younger self and brother are now living. Throughout the episode, we learn that Deke had been keeping an eye on them, and though his younger self still grieves for his parents, he and his brother have become a lot closer, and he's even fixed up his uncle's car. Deke convinces Mac to give his past self the model car finally, and from here we jump to the Zephyr, which we learn they've managed to use to jump backwards once more. They show up to the lighthouse, which is where they reunite, and I'm starting to think, why didn't you go back for Enoch? Eh? You left that poor guy in the past. With Coulson's hard drive, they can give him a new body, and everybody just has a great, great time. That is though, until we see that pesky robot arm with the time stream device making its way slowly across the land. It finally arrives in front of Nathaniel Malik, who it seems must have mastered his Quake powers, and it turns out that he's been communicating with Sybil this entire time. Now she says to him, I'm confident we'll make a perfect pair, which is the same thing that she said to Russell, so it is unlikely that he can trust her. He does however possess the Quake powers though, so if they do try and double cross him, I can see him taking them down. I love though that the Maleks are heavily tied in with the Chronicoms, and it was nice to see him pop back up, as he's probably going to become one of the big villains for the second half of the season, just like how his dad was for the first. Now, we will be talking about the trailer for next week, so if you don't want anything ruined, then I recommend that you turn off now. ABC hilariously posted the promo for this on Twitter, thinking that it was the one for episode 7, so shoutouts if you managed to spoil it for yourself before they took it down. Anyway, there's a couple of cool things that look like they're going to be popping up, including Coulson's new body and the return of Jia Ying, aka Daisy's mother. In case you don't know, Jia Ying was an inhuman that could absorb life and thus remain young. Over the decades, she gained a wealth of wisdom and became the leader of the inhumans, eventually having a daughter with Calvin Johnson. Jia Ying was captured by Hydra, and they killed her and chopped her up, but Calvin was able to reassemble her and thus bring her back to life. The traumatic event changed her massively, and she slowly became hateful of humanity and eventually became the leader of the afterlife, aka the Inhumans on Earth. She started a war against S.H.I.E.L.D. which led to her death, but it looks like things might be different this time round. I can't wait to see her and Daisy reunited, as they clearly have a lot to talk about, and maybe she will steer her away from a dark fate. We also learn that the time drive is broken, which could explain why they randomly jumped and left Deke and Mac in the past. I guess time will tell, but that pretty much wraps everything up, and this was another great entry that I hope you enjoyed our breakdown of. Obviously, I'd love to hear your thoughts on the 7th episode, so make sure you comment below and let me know. If you enjoyed this video, then please drop a thumbs up, and if you missed our analysis of the other episode, then make sure you check it out after this. If you want to support the channel from as little as 99 cents a month, then please click the join button below. We massively appreciate it, and as a thank you, you get access to content early. If you want to come chat to us after the show, either follow us at Heavy Spoilers or click the Discord link in the description below. Every month we give away free movies to people who subscribe to the channel, and this month you can win the MCU Infinity Saga box set, and all you have to do is comment on a video and make sure you subscribe with notifications on. The more videos you comment on, the more you have a chance of winning, so make sure you get involved. The winner is going to be chosen at random on the 15th of June, and the set will be shipped out from then to whoever gets the prize, so best of luck to everyone who takes part. Cheers.